today we have a bard who decides to push things a little too far. Let's throw another log on the fire. So I'm sure you all know of the stereotypical sleazy bard that likes to seduce everything and everyone, right? It's all fun and games, and hey, you can even get out of really tough situations at times. Well, once upon a time, that sleazy bard took it a tad too far. It was the summer of 2020. Everyone was bored out of their minds. My buddy had the bright idea to start a D&D campaign. Now, we were all fairly experienced at D&D, with each of us having at least one campaign under our belts. Me and my friend, who I'll call the DM, and our other friend, who we'll call Adam, all agreed to keep it in our age range. We're all teens, roughly 15 to 16. So Adam, the DM, and I all start to get a few people together. And that list ended up something like this. You have me, the tiefling monk. Think something of an oni. The DM, of course DMing. Adam, the holier-than-thou, lawful neutral paladin. James, the chivalrous gentleman. Ashley, the shy cleric. And lastly, Andrew, our sleazy bard. Now, it would be a good thing to note that Ashley and I were the only girls in the group. Well, I should say that I was playing a girl in the campaign, but out of character, I'm a guy. We were all in a tavern together, dancing to Andrew's musical, uplifting tunes. Adam was chastising Ashley's character for not spreading the good gospel as much as she could. Ashley was writing notes down, and James was dancing drunkenly and happily. It's also worth noting here that Adam and Ashley had a combined story. Well then, in this tavern there was an NPC, a shady man who turns out to have dirt on all of our characters. He revealed that if we didn't help him out, Adam would be ousted as a gambler, a cheat, and a scam artist. James would be ousted for leaving his family behind in search of adventure and money. Andrew would be ousted for seducing his way out of many prison sentences, etc. Even if such weren't true, none of us knew whose stories were true. However, they would all cause irreparable damage to each of our public images. We decided to band together and help this man out with what he needed. It turns out, he was in search of an artifact that was apparently multiple pounds of pure deep sea blue diamond, and it was said to have been blessed by a god. Well, the whereabouts of said diamond were very unknown. However, the only lead that we had was the first king, King Henrik, was the last to possess the diamond. King Henrik was known to be an evil king, and he went mad in his final years as king. He would string people up to large poles, have them be carried out to tubs of corrosive material, and slowly dunk them into these tubs of, basically, acid. Well, when he had died, the people of the land had taken to completely preserve his body, as they didn't want him coming back to haunt them. Well, our first stop was to his tomb, and this is where things start to go wrong. Right as we get there, Andrew starts getting handsy with Ashley. He starts mocking her character and saying, "Ooh, spooky, you should bless this place," while also touching her character's sides and thighs. Ashley was clearly uncomfortable, so the DM broke it up. We head inside and we hear a maniacal laugh echoing throughout the halls. We had to make a wisdom save or else we would be knocked paralyzed. Well, Ashley, James, and I all make the save, however Adam and Andrew fall paralyzed. Ashley, being the good soul she is, picks up Andrew and hoists him on her shoulders. She may be a shy woman, but she was also a cleric with more than enough strength to pick up Andrew. I opted to carry Adam However, James, being the chivalrous individual he is, took Adam off of me and started to carry him. After a few minutes, the effects had worn off, but Andrew refused to let go of Ashley. Again, DM stepped in and made him cut it out. Well, we get to the end of the dungeon. After many traps, puzzles, riddles, and demonic creatures, we get to the crypt. Inside sits a coffin which lies completely closed. Ashley and Adam decide to go check out the coffin while the rest of us checks out the room. As soon as they touch the coffin, it starts to glow green and the coffin lid flies off. Inside lies the mummified corpse of King Henrik, now moving with multiple rings on his finger. Each ring contains a large carat stone of blue diamond, and each ring is trembling with power. Something that not many historians took note of was the fact that the original artifact that we were looking for was cut down into multiple smaller stones used for rings of power. The last remaining bit was put inside of a jar that was buried with King Henrik, which his soul bonded to and turned him into a lesser lich. Well, we fought the lich, and Andrew was at almost no health. As we were packing up our things and trying to get out of there, the ceiling collapsed in, turning the room into a trap in the event of intruders. An acid started pouring into the room. We all quickly start fleeing. However, Andrew, knocked out, was quite a burden for Ashley. As Ashley tripped due to Andrew's weight, she realized what she needed to do. She used the cure wounds on him, restoring him to consciousness, and then booked it with him. They all escaped, and Andrew fawned over Ashley the whole time. As they set up camp for the night to comprehend what had happened, Andrew was getting increasingly closer to Ashley. When all the tents were set up, Ashley and I went to sleep in our shared tent. Well, while we slept, Andrew had apparently snuck into the tent. He had told the DM prior that he wanted to sneak into the tent to surprise Ashley for saving him. The DM suspiciously allowed him to do so. Well, my character, being a monk, had incredibly high wisdom. The DM also let us take one feat at the beginning of the campaign, so I took Observant. My passive perception was high, like almost 20 high. So when he snuck into the tent, my character almost immediately had been woken up by him. He started touching Ashley's character and was trying to assault her. Ashley, being clearly uncomfortable with the situation, was frozen with shock. The DM was about to stop him and kick him out. However, I pulled the DM aside and had a conversation with him. I told him I had a better idea and to go along with it. As my character heard this clear abuse happening, she awoke and then walloped him in the jaw. She then proceeded to start kicking the poop out of him while he was down. Ashley got up and was now unfrozen, and she proceeded to join in. The other party member characters happened to hear the commotion, and taking mine and Ashley's side in this, decided to strip him down to his undies, tie him up by his legs, gag him, and send him off into the woods. The DM then kicked out Andrew, and we kept playing for a few months until scheduling issues came up. I do appreciate the Bard getting his righteous comeuppance. Too many times we have stories where most of the players side with the guy, so this is definitely a welcome change. Fantasy harassment is still harassment, and it's important to shut that down quick. If you are ever in a position where you feel uncomfortable, make sure to make that known to the table. D&D is about having fun, and when one person tries to twist that goal into something more selfish, it is up to the rest of the party to stand together. What do you all think about this situation?